maturity, that is, development is equal to growth plus differentiation plus translocation. We move on to the point number 6, that is prenatal and postnatal growth of maxilla and mandible. Here, try to remember these diagrams, my dear students, if you can. See these diagrams, they are trying to show you what changes take place during the prenatal development of maxilla. Like in number one diagram, we say, around 4th week of intrauterine life, a prominent bulge appears on the ventral aspect of embryo corresponding to the developing brain. Below the bulge, a shallow depression which corresponds to the primitive mouth appears, that is called as conodia. Second diagram is telling you that 5 angle arches form in the region of the future head and neck. Each of these arches gives rise to muscles, connective tissue, vasculature, skeletal components and neural components of the future face. The mesoderm covering the developing forebrain proliferates and forms a downward projection that overlaps the upper part of stomatium. This downward projection is called as frontonasal process. Going further, the stomatium is thus overlapped superiorly by the frontonasal process. The mandibular arches of both the sides form the lateral walls of the stomatium. The mandibular arch gives off a bird from its dorsal end called the maxillary process. The ectoderm overlying the frontonasal process shows bilateral localized thickenings above the stomatium. These are called as nasal platforms. The formation of these nasal pits divides the frontonasal process into two parts, the medial nasal process and the lateral nasal process. And then we say that maxilla develops from the center of ossification in mesenchyme of maxillary process of the arch. This comes as again a non-question in your theory paper by your students, that is postnatal growth of maxilla. Here what you are supposed to write is, you are supposed to write these three heads under which the maxilla grows. Number one, the displacement in the position of the maxillary complex. Secondary displacement occurs in a downward and forward direction as the cranial base grows. Primary displacement occurs in a forward direction. This occurs by growth of maxillary tuberosity in a posterior direction. This results in the whole maxilla being carried anteriorly. Secondly, the growth of the maxilla is explained on the basis of growth at sutures, that is sutural connective tissue mechanism for maxillary growth. It grows by proliferation, ossification, surface acquisition, resorption and translation. Maxilla is related to cranium at least partially by the frontonasal suture, zygomaticotemporal suture, frontotemporal suture, teriopterygoid suture. These sutures are all oblique and more or less parallel with each other. The growth in these areas would serve to move the maxilla downward and forward. This is what is shown in the diagram. Try to copy this diagram and try to write it in your paper if this comes as a long question. Try to explain this on the basis of different sutures and you can draw this diagram. Third way, surface remodeling takes place. Remodeling occurs by bone deposition and resorption to bring about increase in size, change in shape and change in functional relationship. That is, on the left side we have shown you bone remodeling seen in mid-facial region and bone remodeling of the palate resulting in its downward displacement. In summary, growth size in maxilla are, number one, maxillary tuberosity, sutures, alveolar border, nasal septum and surfaces. And it is said that the maxillary length increases by sutural growth and surface acquisition at the maxillary tuberosity. Width of the maxilla increases by the mid-parietal suture and apposition at zygomatic bones, and the height increases by sutural growth, surface acquisition and alveolar growth. You can take a picture of this. See, this summarizes how maxilla grows. So you can make a note of it and you can elaborate it when this comes as a long question. We come to the prenatal growth of mandible. We start with Meckel's cartilage as it is shown in the diagram. Meckel's cartilage is derived from the first brachial arch around the 41st or 45th day of intrauterine life. It provides a template for guiding the growth of the mandible. The ossifying membrane is located lateral to the Meckel's cartilage and its accompanying neurovascular bundle. And from this primary center, ossification spreads below and around the inferior angular nerve and in its incisive gland and upward to form a trough for accommodating the developing tooth bud. Spread of the intramembranous ossification dorsally and ventrally forms the body and ramus of mandible. See, we have shown you arch number 1, arch number 2, arch number 3. You have got the placement of the Meckel's cartilage. And over that, you have the site where the mandible is growing. Endochondral bone formation. In case of condylar process, at about the 5th week of intrauterine life, an area of mesenchymal condensation can be seen above the ventral of developing mandible. This develops into a cone-shaped cartilage by about 10th week and starts ossification by 14th week. You have it in the diagram. And in case of coronoid process, secondary accessory cartilages appear in the region of coronoid process by about 10 to 14 feet of intrauterine line. And in case of medial region, in this region, on the either side of symphysis, one or two small cartilages appear and ossify in the 7th month of intrauterine life to form a variable number of medial ossicles in the fibrous tissue of symphysis. With this as a background, we go into what is a postnatal growth of mandible. This again comes as a long question. See, they'll ask you what define growth and development, describe postnatal growth of mandible in detail. So when this comes as a long question, this is what you are supposed to write, my dear students. That you are supposed to draw a diagram of the mandible, give its different parts, that is the body, the ramus, the condyle, the coronoid process, and in turn, mention at least 3 to 4 sentences on the growth of each so that it contributes to the total growth of the mandible. So it is said that when the mandible appears in an adult as a single bone, it is developmentally and functionally divisible into several skeletal subunits. Basal bone forms one unit to which is attached the annular process, coronoid process, condylar process, angular process, the ramus, the lingual tuberosity, and the chin. Ramus, it moves progressively posterior by a combination of deposition and resorption. Resorption occurs on anterior part of ramus, while bone deposition occurs in the posterior region. This results in a drift in posterior direction. Corpus of the body of the mandible, displacement of the ramus results in the conversion of the ramal bone into the posterior part of the body of the mandible. In this manner, the body lengthens. Angle of the mandible, on the lingual side of the angle of the mandible, resorption takes place on the posterior inferior aspect while deposition on the anterior superior aspect. On the buccal side, resorption occurs on the anterior superior part while deposition takes place on posterior superior part. In case of lingual tuberosity, it moves posteriorly by deposition on its posteriorly facing surface. The annular process, it develops in response to the presence of tooth burns and the chin at the age. As the age advances, the growth of the chin becomes more significant. You need to know the specific growth of the condyle and the coronoid process because this is very important in your further lectures of treatment and other things with the myofunctional appliances. That is the condyle. The head of the condyle is covered by a thin layer of cartilage called the condylar cartilage. It is believed that the growth of the soft tissues, including the muscles and the connective tissue, carries the mandible forward away from the cranial base. Bone growth follows secondary at the condyle to maintain constant contact with the cranial base. We have shown it in the diagram whereby the arrangement of the TMJ is seen. The coronoid process. Although additions take place on the lingual side, the vertical dimension of the coronoid process also increases. This follows the beat principle. Again, summary of mandibular growth sites in the mandibula, mandibular condyle, posterior ramus of posterior border of ramus, lingual tuberosity, and alveolar process. Mandible lengthens by surface acquisition at posterior border of the ramus and resorption at anterior border, deposition at bony chain and growth at the cartilage. Height increases by surface acquisition at alveolar border, lower border of the mandible and condylar cartilage, and the width of the mandible increases by surface acquisition at outer surfaces. You can click a picture of this. See, you need not go into the details about the smaller things. Even if you know this background, you can write at least two to three pages on the topic of summary of mandibular growth. You can draw the diagram, label them, and explain. In short, we'll see what are the clinical implications of growth. They have been given a few terms, my dear friends. There is one term called a safety wall mechanism. What is it? In both male and female, the maxillary intercanine dimension serves as a safety wall for puberty growth spurts where there is a basal horizontal mandibular growth, partly unmatched by the maxilla as the mandible grows downward and forward. Secondly, growth as related to maxilla, if there is a protrusive maxilla, we do the treatment by using a headcare. A headcare is used. A headcare acts to restrain forward growth while the lower jaw continues to grow. Dental changes accompany the headcare treatment, and if you have a retrusive maxilla, it can be successfully moved dentically in young growing children between the ages of 6 to 8 years using face mask therapy or reverse headcare. I again go back to your lecture number 1. By Vasundhara Madam, where she has explained all these things in detail with patients, care and everything. In case of mandible, if you have a small or posterior position mandible, treatment is aimed at mandible using a functional appliance. Here I will make a mention, my dear students, that in your last section of your theory paper, sometimes you get a question whereby we ask you, A child of 9 to 10 years comes to you with Angle's classroom division 1 malocclusion with a retrognathic mandible. Give your treatment plan. So this is exactly what you are supposed to know and what you are supposed to write. So here you are supposed to say that there is a retrognathic mandible. Mandibular growth needs to be propagated or needs to be promoted. So this promotion of mandibular growth can be done by using a functional appliance. So this is where the importance of functional appliance lies. This is where the importance of diagnosis lies, and this is where the importance of basic growth and development lies. In case of large mandible, it is usually more difficult to treat because growth modification for this type of malocclusion is routinely unsuccessful. Camouflage treatment is often attempted, or many patients need to be treated surgically to either move the maxilla forward, the mandible backward, or a combination of the two procedures. Last significance of growth as regards undergraduates is you should know what is growth spurts. What is the importance of clinical importance of growth spurts? We have seen what is growth spurts. Here we will see what is the importance of it. It is said that treatment of skeletal discrepancies is more advantageous in mixed dentition period. Puberty growth spurt offers the best time in cases like predictability, treatment direction, time and management. It is carried out during the maximum growth period, and automatic surgery should be carried after growth.